patients. It also gives certain recommendations. So we'll have a look into certain important parts of the reports. But one unfortunate part is that till date, the recommendations of the reports haven't been adopted. So even though the report was submitted in 2017, and I'm sure like most of us are aware of the fact that in 2019, the criminal law underwent a lot of changes. So despite this change being brought to the criminal law, but most of it has been with regard to the laws that provides more protection issue and failed to address the issue of hate speech. So, but still the observations and the recommendations made by the law committees are noteworthy. I just picked up the most relevant ones, which are essential for us to understand the relevant aspects from the report, which helps us to understand the country. On one hand, the Law Commission of India says that responsible speech needs protection of law because it itself is a part of not just freedom of speech and expression, but another vital fundamental right of individuals in a democratic country like India, and that is liberty. So what's guaranteed under constitution? And especially if that person is from a particular group, or especially if he's from a disadvantaged group. And we all know that a country like India, in fact, has a more challenge because on one hand, we do talk about unity and diversity, so which is a positive connotation. But on the other hand, this also indicates the fact that it's a very sensitive issue in a country that also shows diversity, since we are the country which has diverse caste, creed, religion, dominated with many other grounds upon which diversity can be brought in. So therefore, the law should also aim at bringing in this unity and diversity through these kind of provisions. The Law Commission, in fact, the existing law framework, which already exists in the country, and makes note of the fact that there are a lot of provisions through which illegal contents online can be regulated, especially illegal contents that creates hatredness between the community can anyways be regulated by the existing provisions. But if you notice, these provisions do not directly talk about hate speech, but can be interpreted, can be extended in terms of its scope and ambit by way of providing extended interpretation, at least judicially. So just to mention some of those provisions, so we have provisions that penalize sedition, or that which regulates any act with which one promotes hatredness or enmity between different groups, again groups based on religion, race, or residence, language, etc., thereby affecting harmony in the society. We do have provisions which criminalizes acts that are against national integrity, or those which can affect religious sentiments or bring in differences between religious groups, or can affect religious beliefs of a particular religious community, or using words or other means of communication in a manner in which it would affect religious sentiments of people, or like bringing in hatredness by way of publication or circulation of any contents between certain classes in the society. So we do have elaborate provisions in IPC. In fact, this is the reason why the question that now arises is, in addition to these existing provisions, Law Commission do recommend to add a few more provisions, especially in the context of hate crimes, so especially hate speech. So the whole question is, are we overdoing, do we already have that remedy in the law, at least in the substantive law? So is it even essential to add provisions is one question that we can in fact debate. So otherwise, you do have provisions in IPC, which is extremely wider and elaborate. We do have provisions that are there in other laws, other special enactments, including Representation of People's Act. Now, this becomes extremely crucial in the context of elections. So if a candidate for the election is using these kind of tactics to win over the election or to create enmity between groups, etc., so under this law, or if he promotes enmity between groups based on criteria like race, caste, etc., he can be dealt with under this enactment. And specifically about untouchability, if he's the one that gets incited or encouraged through my hate speech, then I can be dealt with under protection of Civil Rights Act. And in addition, the special enactments, including religious institutions, prevention of misuse act. So this is when I'm using the place which is otherwise meant for religious activities. If I use that to promote disharmony or feelings of enmity, etc., this law will apply. Now, since today we're talking about cyberspace, so some of these are not completely relevant to the hate speech that takes place on cyberspace. However, a difference between the electronic media and social media, maybe laws like Cable Television Network Regulation Act might become relevant, because today we all know that most of the television channels also have their own plays on social media. So what they telecast on their channels is something that immediately gets, or like, you know, there's a live coverage of the same, or at least like later transmission of the same content on social media. So one way of regulating media is by way of regulating it at its very inception stage, when these kind of contents gets transmitted in form of programs on cable television and other platforms, similar platforms. If movies are the modes through which this hate speech is circulated, we do have Cinematograph Act of 1952, which empowers the Board of Film Certification to prohibit of contents, especially if these are parts of movies. So these are all substantive provisions that are provided through IPC as well as special enactments. On the other hand, the Criminal Procedure Code, though is largely a procedural law which lays down procedural rules, but it does also deal with certain substantive aspects by way of prescribing punishments. And especially when it with some provisions of the Criminal Procedure Code would be helpful. For example, Section 95 empowers the state government to fulfill publications which has hate speech contents in it. So that is anyways a procedural rule. But otherwise, Section 107 empowers the executive magistrate to prevent a person from doing anything that would affect public tranquility. So I can issue, in fact, like orders which are similar of wrongful activities, which would have all these, according to me, Section 144, which empowers the district magistrate, the subdivisional magistrate, and other authorities who are empowered on behalf of the state government to issue orders that are essential to prevent the danger that they're apprehending. On cyberspace, there are attempts made in some incidences, which we'll discuss later. There are attempts made to use this provision to block internet communication. Is that right or wrong is another debatable issue. But we've seen certain incidences in our country where 144 has been invoked to, in fact, regulate communication and transmission on cyberspace, especially with the object of preventing apprehension to public order or peace and law and order in the society. Most importantly, most of the offenses that I read from IPC as well as the provisions from the special enactments which deals with hate speech or, you know, similar kind of offense are all made as cognizable in nature. So that shows the seriousness of the offense wherein police officers get power to investigate. In addition to this power, it's important to note that in the name of preventive power of police, the police have got ample power to prevent commission of crime. So let's say preventing commission of crime, this would also mean that I have power to even prevent those acts which I think would incite commission of, say, offenses by another person. So if I feel your content on something that can incite people to commit offense, I can use preventive powers. And my preventive powers under CRPC is very, very wider. In fact, CRPC almost says that the police can do anything in order to prevent commission of crime, though this is subject to judicial restrictions. In fact, like courts have said, as long as the danger is not, like 155 empowers the police to, in fact, you know, arrest a person while exercising its preventive power. So this is the law framework that we have in India, which is also being taken note of by the Law Commission of India. So that's in general as to what happens if there is hate speech that gets circulated in the physical space, or you know, that's used in the physical space. So the whole challenge is when this happens on cyberspace. Especially hate speech on cyberspace refers to an offense which is content-based crime. So I'm either creating these contents which can create hate between community, or I'm transmitting this, or I'm just sharing this. So therefore, this is largely about how do you content, regulate the content. On one hand, if I'm caught, can I be punished or not is what is addressed through the laws that we just saw through provisions of IPs and special enactments. But otherwise, how do you prevent the danger? Because this is on a domain which is, as I just mentioned earlier, very, very difficult to regulate. So therefore, over here, this offense is largely committed in various forms. So one is by the author who's creating those contents, and this saw in the definition, it may not always be in form of words, it can also be in form of representation. So the one who's creating the picture that can create hate, or the one who create hate, or can be in any other visible format. So the one who creates it, creator should be liable or not is one question. Secondly, I create and you know I send it to another person, he circulates. Maybe he's liable, but then how do you prove mens rea on his part, especially if he's just like you know negligently sharing it, or if he's just sharing it without any ill will or mens rea? So these are the questions that complicates the issue. You may have a law which says whoever intentionally creates a disharmony, but especially when I'm just forwarding what I receive on WhatsApp, I'm just liking a post on Facebook. When I like it, gets shared, obviously. So to an extent. In transmission. So that is where this whole question of imposing liability on me becomes you know, unclear. If you can recollect from what had happened in the Facebook arrest case a few years back in Maharashtra, in the context of a content that was written by one girl on Facebook, another girl just likes it. So both of them were arrested. So this is an indication of the fact that over here we're talking about the liability of not just the creator, the author, but also the one who directly or indirectly, impliedly or expressly circulates these materials, either by clicking on like or just by forwarding these contents on other platforms. Forms of social media. So that's something that the law should take a note of. And over here, you know, it becomes important to ascertain whether that party has mens rea or not, and also the possible is where the complication arises, especially on cyberspace. It gets further complicated because of the other challenges that are common to any cybercrime. It includes the issue of jurisdiction, since we're talking about a space which has no geographical limitation. What if it is a content that creates hatredness, yeah, but it's uploaded to somebody sitting in another country? And especially when countries are, during the time of war and all, many times these kind of offenses can be seen to be increased because this is seen as a part and parcel of information warfare. So there may be state-sponsored agencies or individuals, or otherwise also people voluntarily contributing from enemy states to share this kind of material. So how do you regulate it, especially when it is happening from outside the country or has its repercussion in another country? The other problem is that of the concept. So it's extremely difficult to define this term or confine the term to a certain nature of statements or transmissions that takes place online, because what one says may or may not amount to hate speech, and it all depends on the context in which that comment is made, manner in which that comment is made. And many times it becomes extremely difficult to regulate even through technical tools, because what if my statement is a subtle remark? So only a reader is able to understand and not the artificial intelligence. So therefore, legally confining this with the definition is also difficult, and not having definition itself is a challenge for the law enforcement agencies, because scenario. So should it be narrower or wider itself is a debatable question. But lastly, this is all about publication or transmission of the content which has material that can create hatredness between communities. And this material can either be defamatory in nature, or it can be derogatory in nature, or can incite violence in society, or it can incite discrimination in society or discrimination between the communities. Or this can also include contents which can cause insult, annoyance, Sometimes this can also be just against an established principle of laws. Therefore, it can also invoke contempt of court proceedings. So therefore, over here, we're talking about a speech which can have different impact, different context. So having one definition or one law framework definitely is difficult. And with what's been mentioned as the inclusive grounds on which the consequences can be assessed, itself gives an indication that there should be, and it is essential to have multiple laws to regulate all of these forms of statements. So if it is defamatory in nature, suppose I say something about law may also become relevant. If it's about something that is derogatory in nature, so there's a different set of law that needs to apply. If it is inciting an offense in the society, so like CRPC, you may have other laws as well. So therefore, the law will have to vary depending upon nature of content in my hate speech and the context. But why do we need to regulate this? Especially even before it turns out to be violent or it turns out to be insightful in nature, because the impact of this is not just the one that needs to be seen legally, but also there's something that can also psychologically affect people, the readers, or can definitely have its own social impact, can also have sometimes other ways of impacting the individuals or communities. The whole question is, what extent do you hold the author liable, the transmitter liable, and most importantly on cyberspace, where do you hold the intermediary liable? So especially when I'm sharing this on other platforms, like so internet service providers platform, can they also be held liable? So who should be held liable, to what extent, how, when are the questions? A law should address this, looking at, as I just mentioned, the context in which I say something or write something or publish something, as well as the possibility of the consequence or the foresightment with which I write something. Foresightment of the consequence is something that the court should take note of, and also the mode of communication is being used. Especially when we come to cyberspace, Information Technology Act is something that we'll have to go through. The Information Technology Act of 2000 did have a provision which was quite relevant in this kind of a scenario, and that's Section 66A, which in fact criminalized injury or intimidation or obstruction or inconvenience to the reader or to a community. But at the same time, the provision was said to be very, very vague, very, very wider. Most of the terms in the provisions were considered to be vague. And I'm sure most of we know that the Supreme Court in Shreya Singhal versus Union of India, in fact, declared that this section is against freedom of expression. Now, the reason we strike down the provision is they see that this is against Article 91A. And this case has to understand how even the future laws that regulates contents on cyberspace, including hate speech kind of contents on cyberspace, should be. So while striking down 66A, the Supreme Court also says that any law like this, any provision like this, will have to be waived on the basis of Article 92. And Article 92 lays down the grounds on which one's fundamental right to freedom of expression can be curtailed. So as long as your law doesn't fit into those criteria set in 192, any law can tomorrow see the same plight like that of 66A. So therefore, we're looking at amending IPC in the context of Law Commission's recommendation. It's important to ensure that the newly framed provision fulfills that requirements of 192. Otherwise, it might raise the questions of constitutionality. Otherwise, the Information Technology Act, which provides various remedies, including civil, criminal, especially for certain illegal contents that exist on hate crime, some of these remedies becomes relevant. So most importantly, though 66A is removed, but in the context of intermediary's liability, if you see, yes, depending on what I've shared, intermediary can also be subjected to some sort of liability. With what extent, we'll discuss that later. And also, apart from holding them liable, they're also obliged to block access to the contents that are illegal, so which would also include the hate speech kind of a content. Suray 4, one who creates, publishes, transmits, uploads can be dealt with an ITC or other provisions of other special enactments depending on the nature of the content that I've created, published, or transmitted. So about at substantive criminal law. And when it comes to holding liability of these individuals, as I said earlier, we need to look at the state of mind, dementia part. And then whether what I've said comes within Article 2 or not is something that look at. Otherwise, any law which goes beyond Article 2 can be subjected to constitutional restrictions. So keeping all of these in mind, we can say that there are laws that restricts and extend my freedom of speech and expression, especially Article 19.2. And the grounds provided under Article 19.2 should be fulfilled through these provisions that regulates an individual's freedom of speech and expression. So most of the issue relating to hate speech, in fact, can be seen to have some relation with these grounds. So therefore, their regulation through a proper mechanism can definitely be allowed, especially I'm talking about the provision that currently exists in IP. Since if hate speech is unregulated, it can affect integrity of nation. This is an observation made by courts in a lot of cases relating to hate speech. Or if it is something that can affect security of the state, friendly relationship between countries, and most importantly, if my hate speech on cyberspace is otherwise also is something that can affect public order, or is something that is defamatory in nature, or can incite commission of offences, yes, so that those laws can fulfill the requirements of legality. So this becomes important because of the observations made by Supreme Court in Shreya Singhal case to see whether even forthcoming laws fulfills these requirements. Now, in addition to imposing liability upon the one who has created, published, etc., we need to look at the other remedies that are available under law. Now, what if there is an illegal content, there is a hate speech available on, say, a platform like, say, Facebook? So can you get that closed or blocked? Yes, for that, we do have one remedy available under the Information Technology Act. That's called blocking orders. So through this, in fact, you can get the content on those platform blocked. The other similar remedy is called takedown, but takedown is more about removing the contents that infringes IPR, so therefore we will not get into that. But blocking order is something that can be more preventive in nature, at least especially on cyberspace. The longer this kind of content continues, the larger is the impact, the larger is its negative consequence. So therefore it's important that these contents are immediately removed from the space. Parallelly, you can do investigation. Parallelly, you can look at punitive approach. But what you require is an immediate regulation in form of removal of those contents. So can this be done? Yes, it's possible because that's where the intermediary law becomes relevant. Now, coming to the question of who an intermediary is. So we all know that social media is definitely one of the examples of intermediary. But the amendment made to the Information Technology Act in 2008, along with the later on notified intermediary guidelines, makes the law quite comprehensive and also gives a very comprehensive definition to intermediary. So today, intermediary includes telecom service providers, internet service providers, search engines. So if they're able to come across any hate content because of, say, search engines like Google search engine, etc., they can also be questioned, or any other online platforms as well as cyber case are the ones that are brought under the definition of intermediary. It's also important to know that the definition is inclusive. So therefore, what's probably not mentioned expressly under the definition, but ease of the nature, like I'm providing a service which of the nature that's indicated in the first part of the definition, I can also be brought under the definition of intermediaries. That is the one with respect to an electronic record. It includes any person who receives, stores, transmits any records on behalf of another. So this raises another question. Can you consider what's admin as an intermediary? If you look at the first part of the definition, yes, why not? But then if you look at the definition of cyber cafe also, that's also almost wider to include an admin. The only saving clause would be like cyber cafe is defined as the one who provides access to internet, but in the ordinary course of business. So which means there should be some consideration to internet. But otherwise, if you look at the first part of the definition, it's wider to include admin. So this is the reason why sometimes we've, you know, seen, at least through the media, like we've heard about the news of admins getting arrested and all. So whether they should be later arrested or not, so that's when you will see the appropriate sections applicability in a given scenario. If you're sharing hate content, say WhatsApp platform, and this doesn't show any mention on my side, so I can't be liable under IPC. But then if I'm also indirectly encouraging you to post more of such content, so why not? Why can't you, in fact, read in Mensia in my, you know, method of encouraging you? So therefore, it is something that needs to be subjectively seen. Including an admin can see that the law and provided he fulfills certain conditions. And these are laid down under section 79. Now, 79 says that an intermediary cannot be liable for any illegal act, including in the context of a third party's sharing hate speech or hate content on cyberspace, provided I, as an intermediary, do not have the knowledge of what's been shared on my in the context of internet intermediary. So since like a huge amount of data is circulated, content is created, uploaded on cyberspace, you can't expect them to monitor each and every content. So this is a ground that they can easily get. Or secondly, where I'm not actively participated in that illegal content. For example, as an admin, I do not know what's going on, but I'm also supporting you, like, you know, commenting on the post that you're circulating, indicates that there's been an active participation. So some sort of participation by the intermediary can hold him liable. Or the third one is, as long as I'm following all legal requirements, whatever is being said by various laws, including intermediary guidelines, as long as the show with due diligence, these three grounds I can claim exemption. So I repeat, absence of knowledge, no active part for that illegal content that's getting circulated on my platform, as well as in addition, I've complied with due diligence. Now, due diligence is something that needs further elaboration, but before that, so what we see through section 79 is that the law is trying to strike a balance between protecting the interest of the intermediary, that is, these, especially in the cyberspace context, with that of the need to hold them responsible, at least in some occasion where you see direct participation by intermediaries. So that attempt is done through a provision like this. And then there have been other cases where courts have said that, but this is in the context of other cases. So in one of the cases where a PL was in relation explicit contents which were getting circulated on social media, so Supreme Court bench did ask the social media to be more responsive. And in fact, like especially in the context of mob lynching, there have been directions that have come from Supreme Court asking the social media to be more responsive. So which means on one hand, you have section 79, which says as long as you fulfill the three conditions, you're not liable. Make them free from their responsibility, free from their duty when they are supposed to respond to an incident. So they continue be under the legal radar. And when I say due diligence, as I said, this can be showing compliance to laws, regulations that currently exist. And one such law, most importantly, is intermediary. 2011. So, of recently, they proposed amendments to the regulations. I'm not getting into the amendment part, but then existing law says that they'll have to make their users know that they can't publish anything that is illegal. And most importantly, they should ask their users not to share anything that is that is hateful or is racially or ethnically objectionable. So, this is something that I should users known, or anything that you share if he's going to be against the law and order, so I should make you know that I can terminate your service. So which means when you're opening an account on say social media, all these should be indicated in the beginning, and unless you agree to these contents, I shouldn't be letting you to even open an account on my domain. So those kind of requirements are required to be fulfilled by the intermediaries, and any content that affects unit sovereignty of the nation, again, is something that they can regulate by way of requesting their users not to share these kind of contents. Now, despite this, what if it gets shared by someone? As soon as it has been brought to my knowledge, you know, the law requires me to remove those contents within 36 hours. But the whole question is, when does this 36 hours start? Not because what you see, maybe within your reasonable expression of speech and expression, right, within your, you know, reasonable, you know, within your fundamental right. So as intermediary, can I get into the role of a court? Because it's for the court to decide what's unconstitutional, what's against fundamental freedom of speech and expression. So this is something that wasn't clear in the guidelines. Anyways, the guidelines, that is inter- to remove these kind of contents within 36 hours. But at the same time, I had to retain it for 90 days, especially the issue, the contents which would be helpful for investigation. Over here, I'm referring to things that might now to be evidence for a case which, if you know, is under investigation. So these were some of the requirements that I had to comply with, so that, you know, I'm following that case where there's a lawful order that comes to me either through a police officer or any other agency of the state or through court orders, or I'm required to provide assistance to the state. So that's 79. And in addition to 79, we have 69, which empowers the government to issue blocking orders, especially if there is any legal content on the online platform. We've seen how, like, since the last few years, there have been, like, URLs getting blocked, the web pages getting blocked and all. So this is because of the power that the government has under Section 69. So blocking order is one such remedy. Very quickly about the blocking order, 69 of the IT Act talks about the CENTAC procedure. They empower the state government, and in some circumstances, even central government is empowered in general, but state can also do so on the grounds that are mentioned in 69. If you notice, these grounds are almost similar to the words used in 19.2. So it means it's in conformity with 19.2, Article 19.2. So these can be blocked. However, the procedure that needs to be followed in getting blocked is all laid down under 69A rules. It's quite a complicated procedure, but then when you apply for, say, blocking order, and then there's a procedural compliance, and you get the order, you can get the content blocked. But I, as an affected person, so one drawback in the law is I, as an affected person, may not get the details because it's a very opaque procedure that the law provides for. Since in the rule, they say you don't have to disclose this. So therefore, this entire procedure is opaque, but otherwise the one who wants to get a content block can approach the authority. So that's about the 69A rules. Especially in the context of internet platform blocking, sometimes have been helpful because over here we're talking about a platform that has reached a mass number of people. Like you about the content which once goes online is extremely difficult to be removed. Though we're talking about blocking order, so the whole question of, like, how do you block, from where do you block? Are you only blocking it in our country? You also let it get blocked in another country. Practically, it's very, very difficult to block it everywhere, especially if it is already on, you know, platforms around the world. So that's the real concern. In fact, this was also decisions which were made by Solid. You'll be talking about a plan. Pre-censorship, unfortunately, cyberspace has no pre-censorship. At the same time, it has huge impact on the readers, and what goes online, as I said, very, very difficult to bring it down. Or, and then this is something that can reach many number of people, and a lot of research have indicated the psychological impact of these kind of contents that get shared. For example, a few years back, there was a WhatsApp message saying that people Northeast should, you know, go back from other parts of the city, including in Bangalore. This message was circulated saying that you'll have to leave Bangalore within so and so date, otherwise there'll be violent attacks. So this created panic or terror in the minds of people from that specific region. They started leaving the city. So if one small message on a platform like WhatsApp could create this kind of terror in the mind of people, especially because of the nature of technology, you know, eases that transmission so easily. Fraction of second, people can share. And its impact is huge in terms of not the psychological, but legal impact. We need a stringent law. So this, though, was noted by the Supreme Court in Shreya Singhal, but finally their conclusion was this, that on one hand, they say that 79 and 69A are fine. They don't problem with the provision, since, as I mentioned earlier, 69 is completely on par with Article 19, Clause 2. However, they remove 66A, considering it as being against Article 19(1A), that is freedom of speech and expression, since the terms used were very, very vague in the provision, and there were also many incidences of abuse of law, like that Facebook arrest. There were similar incidences. So now the current law is, if there is an illegal content, including hate speech kind of a content on cyberspace, under 79(3)(b), once the intermediary gets actual knowledge of such illegal content, he has a duty to remove those illegal contents. But what do you mean by actual knowledge? So this is where the Supreme this should be brought to their actual knowledge, either through a court order or through a government agency's order. So either, like, for example, under Section 90-91, the police officer can write to that concerned social media platform and ask them to remove, or you have to go to the court, get an order. So which means common people, if they approach the social media platform, they may or may not issues of the judicial authority. That is where they require the orders from a court or from the government agency. And then government agencies, do they have to issue blocking orders or other restrictive orders? So that's when they see whether the contents of mine is against Article 19(2). If so, it's only then that it gets removed. That the court arrived at in Shreya single judgment, they uphold 69 and 79 and strike down 66A. So therefore, what we see today is punitive approach that one can see through provisions like IPC, regulatory and preventive approach that one can see through provisions like 79, where they're required to block access, read with 69E. And what's also something that can be briefly noted through sections like 144 is a preventive approach, especially where I see that, you know, this is a situation where people can start sharing contents that can create hatredness, etc. They can block internet access. But over here, personally, I have my own reservation, because over here we're talking about, on one hand, we're talking about right to internet as a fundamental right of people of internet. This, in fact, came up as a question of as a legal question in two incidences. One, when in Gujarat, similar 144 orders were issued to restrict internet access, but that's where the court did not completely take a stand, and they allowed these kind of orders. While on the other hand, recently this issue came up even in context of Jammu and Kashmir, where there was complete blocking of internet access. The court were that these kind of orders cannot be issued for a longer period. So which means indirectly they indicate that you can have some sort of, say, preventive measures, but it cannot be for a longer stretch of time, etc. Or like it can't be complete restriction. So there can be reasonable restrictions that can be imposed on your internet coverage. But what we require in this context is to have a comprehensive mechanism, because what you've noticed is, like, on one hand holding an individual liable, on the other hand holding intermediaries responsible, not liable, especially when this a whole illegal content needs to be regulated. So if we try to draw some solutions from other jurisdiction, we can have a look at what's been approached with European Commission. So European Commission, in fact, specifically looks at contents that can incite terrorism. It's a wider term, but can include some sort of hate speech which can create terror amongst communities in the mind of people just because they belong to a particular community. This can also include otherwise illegal hate speech. And over here, these commissions have come up with their own guidelines, especially required intermediaries to be more responsive. So in the context of these kind of contents, intermediaries are required to quickly and proactively detect, remove and prevent these kind of contents. So which means you don't have to go to the court and all in all the cases, as long as it's very clear that these are illegal contents, these are hateful contents, they're required to immediately detect this by their own. So this is where our technical solutions to an extent may be helpful, not completely, but to an extent. And once you detect, remove it. And but at the same time, since we're talking about fundamental right of freedom of speech of another person, there should be a fair procedure when you decide to detect. And that's also ensured through the European Commission's other rules, which I'll explain a little later. But otherwise, the approach is more preventive. Procedure through which they take care of the right of the author or the one who's transmitted. So I need to be informed about this procedure that you're going to resort to. I need to be heard. So only upon being heard, the contents that's been uploaded by me can be removed. So this is how they also ensure that there is a fairness that is intrinsic in the entire. About intermediaries' obligation to use technical tools, as I just said, like have filters in place, have artificial intelligence, you know, kind of programs in place so that you can detect. But especially in a country like India, it's very, very difficult because this is a country where we have multiple languages. So what I say in one particular religious language, unless the AI, artificial intelligence, is programmed to even detect that, it'll be difficult. Having a technical tool which can read in all these languages, which can filter down based on the terms that are used in the languages. At the same time, as I said earlier, sometimes it will still fail. It can't be a comprehensive solution because what if it's just a subtle comment that I've made? So that's where the technology fails. But yes, technology can be a good combination too, along with the legal remedies. Right is what they foresee from the intermediary. Especially, they require the intermediaries to have their own mechanism of, say, regulating illegal contents in such a manner that they don't unnecessarily encroach upon fundamental rights of another. And they, in fact, also expect that big industries come with a proactive mechanism and share their experience with smaller platforms. Now, this becomes relevant for in India. Intermediaries also includes the small entities, and we as of now see almost all intermediaries in the same way. So we have a blanket provision that is intermediary guidelines, which applies to every or any kind of intermediary. Now that's the reason why WhatsApp admin, his liability is still a complicated question in our country. So equating my status with that of an intermediary between different platforms, and accordingly the regulatory mechanism can vary, accordingly the liability component can also vary. And also what they do in US, and which we've also been seeing off recently in our country, is that their intermediaries are expected to work closely with concerned departments of government. In India this was lacking, but off recently, due to some of the directions given by Supreme Court in various cases, not just in relation to hate speech but also or in cases of child pornography, courts have asked intermediaries to be proactive. So they've been closely working with law enforcement agencies, especially since last few years, we've seen that intermediaries are closely working with election, especially during election, with concerned departments of the government. So that is a welcome change that we're seeing in our country. So therefore, the solution is something. It's important to know that the Law Commission of India, on one hand, reiterates what's been declared earlier to even courts as fundamental right to freedom of speech is an essence of the democracy, but it requires its own limitations, especially when it is something that can affect public order. So therefore, this requires judicial scrutiny, and something that was also indirectly connoted by the court in Shriya Singh's judgment, indirectly. They're more talking about 66A, not exactly about hate speech, but any kind of sentence. So, and then what they say is, same thing is referred to by Law Commission of India. So therefore, the court relies on Shriya Singhal's observation and says, the Law Commission relies on Shriya Singhal's hate speech, which has the tendency to create incitement, is what needs to be restricted. Incitement of what is the next question that the Law Commission tries to address. They say incitement to violence, as well as incitement to, say, discrimination. So as long as what I see on cyberspace and has the potential to incite violence or to incite discrimination, or published on internet can be subjected to, if hate speech term can be defined or not. So they refer to how internationally this term is being defined, and they say that this includes any expression which is abusive, insulting, or incites violence or creates discrimination between communities, identified the communities or the groups which are identified based on race, religion, place of birth, region, language, caste, community, sexual orientation, personal convictions. So they refer at the end, they say that in our country, I don't think we should define the term hate speech, since we have a clearer indication that comes through Article 19.2. So I do agree with this observation of the Law Commission of India. So now the question is, to what extent do we regulate this? So as long as the, well, here again, what Law Commission says is something that is noteworthy to be seen from the context of hate speech on cyberspace, especially as long as my speech is not offensive, it shouldn't be regulated, is not inciting, shouldn't be regulated, isn't, and then also depends on who is the one who is circulating this message or creating this message. This is especially in the context of like hits, you know, contents that are shared during the election. So who's the one who's sharing? Is it the one who's in power to influence the listeners or the readers, the status of the victims of speech, and the potential the possibility of invoking that hatredness amongst the community through my speech and the context of my speech. And then the Law Commission talks about three tests, which is also similar to what the court had said in the context of right to privacy in Puttaswamy. It's almost similar. So when that, provided you have a law that prescribes that you can do this, so there should be a prescription to do so, to restrict by law. And in fact, you've seen how in IPC you have so many sections relating to sedition, integration, national integration, etc. So you have a law. Secondly, that law should indicate the aim that it wants to achieve, and that aim should be legitimate, which was in fact lacking in a provision like 66A. And lastly, there should be a need to regulate my freedom of speech and expression. So there should be a this, it's fine. Ultimately, Law Commission recommended two important changes to IPC. They recommended for insertion of two specific sections, which they think was required to prohibit hate speech, especially the one which can incite hatredness or which can create fear or alarm or provoke violent acts in the society. So in addition to this, they say that CRPC, so they do recommend changes to both IPC and CRPC in this context. Today's status, as I mentioned in the beginning of the talk, these changes haven't still been implemented. Very recently, there was a PIL which was filed before Supreme Court, asking the Supreme Court to immediately direct the government to implement these recommendations made by the Law Commission in 2017 March. So this petition was filed in 2020 March. However, this is still pending. In this case, initially the Supreme Court said that we don't have to separately hear this matter. This can be clubbed with an ongoing matter, but nothing else is so far being confirmed by the court. So what do we need in the future? So we need not just the law, because as we've already noted, there are a lot of provisions which can be used to even regulate hate speech. In the absence of the recommended provision, you can still use, but what you require you is an extended interpretation of this provision. So in that way, you can use the provision. But most importantly, it's important to sensitize the social media users so that there is a self-imposed restriction and ethical obligation that can be expected of the user. But this is extremely difficult, as I said. There is diversity and technical solutions like artificial intelligence, filtering process, etc. And then comes the legal remedies. But as of now, we have legal remedy, but what we lack is effective implementation of these legal remedies, which are in form of substantive provision. So maybe that's where we need to relook at the procedural law aspect. So therefore, over here, we're talking about easily accessible to a large number of people, and this can affect a larger audience if it is unregulated within a short span of time. And especially because ours is not just a democratic country, ours is a plural country where we will have to balance the two concerns, the fundamental right of one and the security of the state, the law and order in the community, the harmony in the community. So this is in brief about the law framework that we have in our country with the challenges that emerges on such days. If you have any questions, you can take. Thank you.
I'm audible.
Yeah, I can hear.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am, for giving your valuable insight on this topic and illuminating us with your vast knowledge on this issue, as I believe it has been a very contemporary issue in the digital era. So, we request you kindly address it. The first being, what are the basic provisions of CRPC and IPC which may interrelate with the Information Technology Act in relevance to hate speech in cyberspace?
Okay.
Technology Act in relevance to hate speech in cyberspace.
So therefore, one provision that I've personally seen been invoked in the context of any kind of illegal content has been sections like 90 and 91, firstly, because this empowers the authorities under the law, including police, to send notices to, including to social media platforms, asking them to say either share evidence or block contents, etc. So that's one, though is not directly related to this, but I've seen it's being used in a large number of cases. But the question is, should the social media platform intermediary will respond to this or not? There have been a couple of cases where they've been responding, especially off recently, since there's like, you know, increased awareness amongst people and more expectation from the intermediary side, a lot of directions coming from court side, and also we see that they do respond in terms of certain illegal contents, but not necessarily in all the kind of illegal contents. Especially child pornography, they've been responsive of recently. And also, if the content is such that it can create terror, or like, you know, it gets related to terrorism, they've been responsive. But otherwise, just like, you know, comments about a community and all, they may or may not respond, because that's when they expect you to come with a court order. So one is 90-91. The second one is 144, which is being used in places like Gujarat, Jammu and Kashmir. But personally, as I said earlier, I'm not convinced with the usage of this provision, because this otherwise curtails that freedom of speech and expression on one hand, and our right to access internet. In addition to this, empowers the police issuing preventive orders or in preventing any commission of crime. So so that includes sections like 107, that includes sections like 144 also. In fact, the words used in the code is that to prevent commission of any cognizable offense, police can do anything that's necessary for that situation. So anything that's necessary would also mean like doing other regulatory acts, etc. But these are all subject to like how the court would later consider in the context of cyberspace. But generally, whatever is the power that they can use in the offline scenario, they can use it in online scenario in the name of preventive power. And 107 empowers the executive magistrates and all to fulfill these contents. So, but then this might not be relevant when it comes to cyberspace, because over here we're not circulating these kind of contents through books or through print media, etc. But they can use it to an extent on cyberspace by way of interpreting their power in a different context, like by way of like issuing stay orders, etc. So there are provisions which can be used, but then what's required is a specific provision in the context of cyber. Context of health, hate speech on cyberspace. So that is obviously lacking.
Okay, ma'am. The second question being, there have been cases where the post on the social media platform has been disqualified on the use of certain vulgar terms which were necessary to explain the crux of that post. So don't you think there should be a laws, specific laws that don't disqualify a certain post on the basis of just few terms and not on the, not like focus on their inference?
Right. See, I agree. So, in fact, that's why Shreya Singhal's judgment becomes extremely important. Shreya Singhal's judgment, in fact, like talks about the terms that are vague, which were there in the provision. Message, you know, that has annoying content, menacing character. You know, at least over here, you're using the word vulgar. So, you know, otherwise also any term that is annoying, menacing character, has thing that can insult another, intimidate another. So, this is what the court refers to and takes note of in Shreya Singhal's case and says that, no, everything like this can't be regulated. And therefore, only those fulfills the requirement of 19 clause 2 can be regulated. So therefore, if at all they're just blocking, you know, your writings or like your web pages, your blogs, simply because they think it's against their community standards. So that's where this question of legality arises. So, right? So Shreya Singhal says you can't just block all this content. So even like, you know, using the same word of the person who's asked the question, for one, you know, it can seem to be an annoying content or like vulgar. For another, it need not be. So this is where you require the legal test to apply. And we've just discussed what are those legal tests. And this is where you need a judicial application of mind. It's the court which would decide whether my writing has been abusive or not, has been illegal or not, or in this context of the topic that we're discussing, hateful or not. But allowing the intermediaries to themselves decide, that is the danger. So that is where we see that of our freedom of speech and expression. But unfortunately, this is happening. And as I said, 69A, you know, procedure is a very opaque procedure. You will not even know for what reason your content was removed many times. They don't have to answer you. I think 69A also, not as a provision, it's fine, but the procedure laid down and the provision is something that requires judicial review. So you'll have to wait till then. But otherwise, I agree that sometimes removed because they feel it's against their community standard, or they feel that, you know, it's against the set of standards that they've prescribed. But any such standards, if are not in compliance with 19.2, it is illegal, it is unconstitutional.
Okay, ma'am, the final question being, what can be a more obvious modus of hate speech on social media? Counter speeches or alternative narrations, like if someone posts their views on social media, so there are counter views on that. So what is more obvious modus of hate speech?
See, that's where I said it all depends on, like, you know, the parties can be different. The initial author, or like, you know, you can be the second author because of your comment, your counter comment, or you can have a third author. So maybe what I write as an, you know, original author, I might not have said anything that can amount to hate speech, but your comment to my post can be the one that needs regulation. So therefore, it can be any. So what's regulated in through this law is that speech which is hateful. So it can either be a counter comment, it can be a reviewer's, you know, comment, it can be any. So as long as yours is something that can provoke that hatredness between communities, though it's not legally defined, but if it can attract this provision, so why not? So I think it can emerge in any form. You know, it can add to someone's, you know, hateful content. Your comment can add, or it can in itself independently be you know, something that can create the offense for the first time. So therefore, it can be any of this, and it needs to be subjectively seen in the case.
Thank you so much for addressing these questions. Now, as you came approaching to end the session, so now I would like to invite Dr. Kumar Sun. Yeah, I'm audible.
Yeah, Junan, you're audible.
So I'd like to invite Dr. Kumar Askan Pandey, sir, who is the Associate Professor of Law at Dr. RML NLU and Coordinator of the Center for Criminal Justice Administration and Editor-in-Chief of CCJ Blog. So I would request you, sir, to speak few words and deliver the vote of thanks to the Honorable Speaker. Next to you,
sir. Thank you, Junan. A very good evening to one and all. I was glued to the screen and very keenly listened to each and every word that Professor Nagaratna spoke. What an enthralling session we just had on such a topical issue, to hate speech in cyber. In an era when there is a growing clamor for right to offend, of course, it's very important that we draw boundaries and we draw limitations as to where what is offensive turns into what is hateful. I express my gratitude to Dr. Nagaratna for sparing her time and sharing her valuable thoughts on this very fascinating topic. It was so elaborate. You have asked that would you be kind enough to share your PPT with the audience. Of course, it's going to be your decision, but if you would do that, I would also be, I think, very much obliged. Thank you very much. To the enthusiastic bunch of the students who are the real movers and shakers, as I always say, behind such kind of events. I also thank the Vice Chancellor who keeps motivating us. And last but not the least, the audience who were equally spellbound throughout the session. Thank you very much. Once again, have a safe, both online and offline. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Kumar. Thank you, Junaid. Thank you, everyone. Thanks a lot.
Yep. So with the ending of session, I would tell the participant that they will get their certificate on their respective email IDs. Thank you. Thank you so much.